I'll unmute myself there. Gabor, thank you very much for that. Just double checking that you can hear me okay. Brilliant, thank you. Well, hello everybody, my name is Johnny. I wanna take you through my perspective on another trend we're seeing, which is around internal mobility. And this is something that has been a big theme that kind of really started being talked about in mid-March, late March, as the pandemic really took hold. And whilst adding to Holly's advice, and she's touched on some of these areas, I wanted to focus in on this particular area, which isn't new. The area of internal mobility or internal hiring, internal recruiting is not new, but the focus it's been given and the team who's now being, for sometimes the first time ever, being asked to look at this, the recruiting team, is new and new for a lot of companies. I want to talk to you about that. And to me, this is the secret of success in this pandemic in a hiring situation that we're in at the moment. I got to just maybe, you know, give you guys a little bit of break from speakers and give you a snippet from one of my favorite movies when I was a kid. Some of you may know this if you're as old as me. If not, maybe it's the first time you've been introduced to it. So yeah, bear with me while I humor you with maybe 50 seconds of this.
I'll get dressed.
Yes, sir. I'll move my stuff in.
Great, Jean. Good idea.
Listen, I have some notes here. I also have some charts, some graphs, some tapes. They're all sorted into different departments. You read my handwriting?
Sort of.
Do your best. Oh, I need some poster boards, some colored pencils, some colored push pins, T-square, drawing table, lots of pencils, and my lunch. Chinese. Hey, 4319?
Yeah.
Great. Morning.
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 Good morning.
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 Hi.
Why the obscure reference to a movie from 1987 with Michael J. Fox, you might wonder. Well, this was a real favorite of mine when I was a kid. And one of the things that really appealed to me was that this is a story about a kid from Idaho, whatever that meant to you as growing up or it means to you. It was a kind of a small town kid from out of the city who went to the big city to get a job. And his uncle hires him in his company and he starts in the mailroom. This kid wants more than just to work in the mailroom. And through some convoluted circumstances at the start of the movie, he manages to fake it as a senior executive. And the movie plays out and he plays the senior executive faking it essentially through the movie. And it's a bit of fun. It's humorous. It's a silly movie. But I really loved this. As when I was a kid, all I wanted to do was be a businessman, to have a briefcase and go to work in an office, right? That was my dream, okay? I didn't have much more beyond that, but that was my dream. And this movie showed me that somebody could go in and then get into that role. And that's what internal mobility is meant to be all about. How do you move within the organization? How do you start somewhere, but eventually run the company or run a department, right? And it doesn't happen too often. But there are simple ways to make this work in an organization. I want to talk to you about the why of it as well. So in this kind of 20, 25 minutes that we have together, I want to share with you why internal mobility actually matters, why it should be important for the organization you're working in or working for. I want to talk to you about the new focus that 2020 has brought to that and give you a glimpse at what the future could look like. And then finally, take you through some simple steps to be actually successful in delivering on internal career mobility success. So let's get started. First thing I want to talk to you about are the benefits of internal mobility. So we've seen a lot of stuff about employee attrition over the year. And the number one reason why employees say that they leave a job, 40% of people say it's because they lacked career development. They lacked the opportunity to move on, to work on new things, to get promoted, to work in a different area. It is the single most quoted reason why employees leave an organization. So to keep good staff, all we got to do is give them more career development. Employee kind of attrition costs organizations a fortune. And for a lot of us, that's what drives most of our hiring. Wouldn't it be better if the hiring just didn't happen in the first place, if we could just move people around? Now, of course, if you're clever, you'll understand that that doesn't reduce the amount of hiring. It actually just moves the hiring to perhaps different roles, hopefully lower skilled roles that are easier to hire for and cost the business less money and have less risk. So it's moving people around in the organization to fill the more senior roles as they come up and constantly having a pipeline, perhaps at the lower levels, the more junior, more volume roles to get people into the businesses. Lots of organizations do this well. They hire big graduate programs. And as you work your way up, certain people leave, but they always fill those senior positions with internal talent. But many don't do it. And increasingly, in the last few years, we've seen a lot of organizations move away from that. But there are more benefits to that. Highly engaged teams are more likely to show profitability. And there's a Gallup poll, which I've shared a link to here, shows that engaged teams are more profitable. And engagement is much higher when teams have development opportunities, okay? The most successful organizations make employee engagement central to their business strategy. And engaged teams are going to be more profitable. And engagement is the thing people are looking for with career development. So it drives more engagement in your staff. You will have a higher number of individuals engaged, which drives more profitability, reduces absenteeism, reduces turnover as well. So internal mobility is really tied to a lot of business outcomes like profitability, greater revenue, greater opportunity, more ideas as well. So having that higher engagement by giving more opportunities, more focus on development is a no-brainer from organizations. People leave unchallenging work, not a challenging workload. There is that common misconception that, you know, people are too busy or, you know, they hate their jobs, they have too much on, they have too much to do as such, right? This is a great piece of research by a software company called Peakon, and they've got a great bunch of reports available free on their site in their heartbeat section. And this shows that 9 months before an individual actually leaves an organization, before that separation event, they start rating their work as unchallenging. All right. So that begins that accomplishment challenge. If you look at that top graph, the kind of more blue or gray line. When asked, I have the opportunity to do challenging things at work, you see that begin to drop off about 9 months before they resign. So it takes 9 months from when they begin to first feel unchallenged to drop off. Yet when they their workload and how manageable that workload is doesn't really change over that period, right? There isn't a kind of my workload became too much, so I need to find a new job. It's not the amount of work, it's the challenge of that work. And so it isn't just that they're looking for necessarily a promotion or more seniority. It's just that they want to move on to challenging work, more interesting work, which is key to internal mobility and moving people around. And I love this. This came out of Wharton Business School in the US. They were able to show that internal hires perform faster, right? So the outside hires take about 3 years to perform as well as an internal hire in the same job. But critically, internal hires are taking about 7 years to earn as much as an outside hire would for that role. So for organizations, internal hires are generally more successful. Their time to kind of productivity is much, much faster, and they will cost you significantly less money. Again, no brainer. And you probably won't be too surprised why organizations therefore are looking at internal mobility as a new focus. COVID-19, the pandemic, the financial climate that it's left us with has driven a lot of these kind of changes. You have organizations who are downsizing and letting go of thousands of staff and parts of their business. Those organizations are also probably having to transform whilst they let go staff. So you're losing a lot of staff because you have to reduce costs, but you also have to, you know, adjust your business, deliver your service in a different way. That could be because of the pandemic and the lack of access to your facilities, if it's stores or retail. It could be that people want distribution. They want stuff to be shipped to their home. It might be that they require different goods or they plan to use your service in a different way. But companies have to adjust, which means they have to have perhaps different skills or new skills whilst they're laying off staff. It doesn't go down well to lay off staff and then hire lots of new ones. So they are looking to their internal staff to see how you can move people around, how you can reuse the talent that we have as well, recycle that talent. That's become a big theme in the last 7 months. You've seen business models adjust, organizations like IKEA. If you think about IKEA, you might think, well, IKEA are doing great out of the pandemic. You know, their stores are busy. People are doing up their homes, building home offices, putting new furniture in. And yes, IKEA are generally doing well, but the shape of the business has changed a bit. they would have been much more about in store. You know, you go into the store, into the showroom, and you walk away with your goods. IKEA's online business has exploded since March. It's become a much bigger part of their business. So you think about an IKEA store, you might employ the same amount of staff, but perhaps more people are working in the warehouse, fulfilling orders to be shipped out from online orders than are at the checkouts. At the front of house, perhaps taking cash off customers because they're afraid to go into the store, afraid to be around each other. So again, the business might fundamentally still be doing well, but the shape of the workforce has to change. That's moving people around, reskilling them, getting them into new roles. But we've seen this from all the surveys. LinkedIn survey, which they run every year, talks about why people leave jobs and why they join new jobs. Top reason why they left: I was concerned about the lack of opportunities for advancement. You know, why did they join? A stronger career path and more opportunity for advancement. So this is the no-brainer way to stop the bleeding of your workforce, the workforce you don't want to leave. They're leaving because they're not finding new opportunities because you aren't solving this problem. And it's you're going to have to try and satisfy it for all the new people joining you. You're going to have to try and show them that you do have these opportunities that your current workforce are saying we don't have. So it is a big, big HR challenge. What is the current state? You know, this is not a new topic. I'll say this again. I'm keen to hear what your thoughts are. I might stop and ask those of you on the call, maybe jump into the chat and let me know, you know, so far, so good. You're nodding your head going, yes, I agree. This makes sense. I'd love to hear if you're hearing this from your own hiring managers, if you're an in-house recruiter, or if you're in an agency, if you're hearing this from clients, that they're putting more of a focus on trying to find internal talent for jobs. I'd love to maybe just get your thoughts, jump into the chat, let us know, yes, I'm hearing this, no, and maybe some context. So I'd love to maybe hear some of those comments or and we'll kind of view them or read them as we go along. So please jump into the chat and let us know. But the current state of internal mobility is that it's broken. So when you ask people about how they're doing it, a lot of the internal staff will say, you know, there's no real visibility of what jobs are available. You know, all of a sudden someone's hired, I didn't even know there was a vacancy there. Or that managers are vetoing their own staff from applying for new jobs. They're saying, well, no, you can't take my staff member, I need her, so she can't go apply for that job. And that in the process, the recruiter, and again, I'd love to hear your opinions on this, the recruiter isn't responsible for internal talent. So if you're an in-house recruiter, you're responsible for shortlisting the external talent, but perhaps there's a different process for internal talent. And when you do move talent around, it's more about moving countries or moving businesses, not really about departmental moves. More like, I want to work in our US office. Great, we can facilitate that. And then you come back. It isn't really about cross-departmental moves, which perhaps are more challenging. Deloitte ran a survey last year, they run it every year, on global human capital trends. And the latest one that they published looked in particular at this area of internal mobility. And they asked respondents, what are the most challenging barriers to internal talent mobility for the business? And then number one was lack of process to identify and move employees. Number two, close behind it, the availability of internal employees to fill roles, which I'd argue is just a visibility issue. No one's showing them who's there. Current managers' resistance to internal moves, the blockers, lack of information for employees on what roles are available, no brainer. And it's not surprising then that the majority of people just didn't rate their organizations very high at enabling internal talent mobility. So only 6% said excellent, 36% said good, and the rest, which is, gosh, 59%, said it was either fair or inadequate, which is just terrible, right? It's not done very, very well. What is the solution behind this? So if you're either in-house or you're external and you're looking to try and understand your value, and the value is being able to sell into the organization what they can do to solve this. Remember that you are there to solve people issues. So it could be external hires, but it could be something else. How can you be a really good advisor to that team, to that hiring manager, to the organization? Well, first of all, it's not just a recruitment project. Internal mobility must be owned by the wider HR organization with buy-in from senior management. So their buy-in and their sponsorship is essential. We've talked to lots of organizations about how they're doing this, what works, what doesn't work. I'll give you an example of an organization who've been doing this for 10 years and doing it really well. And that's the bank Standard Chartered Bank. So Standard Chartered today all of their jobs are aggressively, and I say aggressively, marketed internally. They go to great lengths to try and promote those jobs amongst the existing workforce, to raise awareness, to market the jobs. Internal applicants are given priority over external applicants. They understand that internal applicants, for all the stat reasons I've shared earlier, statistically are better. They're less expensive, they'll perform better, and they'll be faster to productivity, all of these things. But they're also given confidentiality. When you apply for a job, your manager will only be told if and when you get a new job offer. If you get a job offer, only then will they be informed that you are moving jobs, and they will be afforded the notice period of your contract before you start your new job. They can't block you, essentially. And recruiters not just allowed, but even encouraged to contact internal staff about openings. They don't have it freely across the organization, but they are allowed to reach out to internal talent, certain lists and certain departments where they can actually source within for different roles for the business, which is really, really progressive. But I'm not saying this is for everybody. There are obvious challenges. And when you talk about internal mobility, when I ask organizations about doing this, again, they agree in principle, but they raise the challenges. The challenges include things like, you know, they're worried that the best people will be poached by other departments that have bigger budgets. So hiring managers are afraid that their budget isn't big enough to keep these talents, and they'll always have vacancies. They'll have more internal attrition. You'll have people leaving the team, and therefore are going to have more roles to fill, even though they're staying in the organization. Or, you know, teams are constantly stealing from feeder teams. So you might have, for example, in sales, you might have a business development team, and the account management team are poaching from that BD team all the time, or the SDRs, sales development reps, are being poached to the main sales force. So you have a high amount of vacancies in SDRs, low amount of vacancies in salespeople. Again, these are challenges. They are real issues, right? There's no point in ignoring them. But there are ways to get around them. And we surveyed and asked customers, what are you doing? What works? And generally speaking, we found that there are many ways to solve these problems. But overall, you need a phased approach. You don't necessarily do it all at once. You don't have a big bang approach where you, all of a sudden, you look at the best practice model and say, we'll do all of that and we'll do it tomorrow. It's easier on the organization, particularly large organizations, to bring it in phase by phase. I'll tell you a story about what Oracle have begun doing around the world. So Oracle, again, as an organization looking at internal mobility, they focused on the promotion of the jobs. So the first part that they're really working on, and they're doing it on a pilot basis in certain countries and markets and expanding it, you know, every quarter into a new market, is that they've been aggressively running career fairs. Now, before COVID, these were in person. And they were launched, first of all, in Brazil was the first market they did this, where they initially ran an in-person career fair, where in the big main building in whatever the office was, maybe it's Sao Paulo or whatever, they would literally launch a fair with stands and booths, and people would come from different offices and they would meet the different teams. So each department would have somebody there selling the role or the career opportunities in their departments, and other Oracle staff could come and ask them. So someone from marketing could say, what's it like in sales? What are the job roles? How much do you pay? Why should I work in sales excessively, et cetera? And they were marking their open positions. But really interesting, they also did things like they ran CV and resume prep seminars. They ran seminars on how to build a really good LinkedIn profile, which may seem counterintuitive. Well, why would you help them build a LinkedIn profile when that could help them leave Oracle? But they figured that, you know, they needed to promote themselves to get the internal jobs. And yes, there's a risk they could use that advice and go external, but rather be there trying to help them as a partner than ignoring the fact that they're unhappy and then having to see them go off to an external career fair and get the same advice. But that was really, really clever. I talked to a lot of companies who, again, looked at their process. Again, back to the process, typically the shortlist that the hiring manager would receive from the recruiter is a vetted list of external candidates. And oftentimes what I heard was the internal talent was literally just handed to them. So every internal applicant was just handed to them, unvetted, unscreened. So you can imagine you're the hiring manager. You have this lovely shortlist of 6 great candidates from the recruiter, beautifully presented with all the details. And then you get 56, you know, just CVs sent to you with no more information apart from what was sent into them. You're, of course, going to go for the external candidates because it's a better process. So process-wise, it can really simply start with just merging the two, having your recruiter build the shortlist for everybody, internal and external. Certainly, if you're an internal recruiter, you should be doing this. But even if you're the agency recruiter, offering to do the same process. Do you want me to run through and prep and screen your internal candidates? You know, maybe changing the way you charge for your services in that way as well. This is what organizations want. Be part of the solution. Don't fight it. You can communicate the benefits of internal candidates. You can highlight somebody and then talk about the lack of experience, not as a negative, but as a, this is a very trainable skill. We could train this skill in 3 months. I know she doesn't have it on her CV, but we have a program in the L&D department that could help us fix that. And by the time she gets up and running, you know, she'll have the skills versus this person who's external, who says they have the skill, but do they really, do we know much about them? Confidentiality, really, really important, right? It's so important to remove the requirement to inform managers. But maybe you start small. Don't start with this across the board. Maybe you start with some teams. So you start as a pilot to show that it's not going to cause a massive problem. And you work with the recruitment team and you encourage the hiring teams to work with the recruiting team. So for example, if you see one department, their team have all applied for lots of different roles, you no longer can tell the department, but what you can do is inform them that you expect there to be attrition. Hey, we've had a lot of applications from this team for other roles. They won't all get the roles, of course, but some of them probably will. And we see that these types of skills are probably going to need to be hired for. So I'm going to start pipelining for you. I'm going to start giving you more candidates. You don't have any open vacancies, but I'm going to work with you because I understand this would be a problem. I don't want it to be a problem. Let some of those staff go find new careers in our organization. Let me solve the backfilling problem and let me just get ahead of it before it becomes an issue for you. Or you look at Microsoft, brought this in several years ago as well. They have really moved towards internal mobility and they've kind of learned what works and what doesn't work. And they have recruiters now more actively searching for candidates internally. It's not across the board for everybody. So there's some guidelines. For example, you have to have a milestone achievement behind you, which usually means 6 to 12 months experience in Microsoft, a positive performance review, et cetera, before you can be approached by the recruiting team or you can apply for internal jobs. They have things like high potential lists that are immediately available to source from. So again, thinking about these things, who have we identified as high potential that we could go after straight away and kind of bring into our shortlist, these new combined shortlists of external and internal candidates. And really, you know, it's not that difficult, but following some of those steps and taking that as a phased approach, this really is the recipe for success. And I hope if you're following this and this is something that you think your organization or your clients are interested in, you can really advise them on how to do it well. And you can hopefully end up with an outcome a bit more like this.
Excuse me.
Thank you, folks. Back to you, Gabor.